I cannot think of modern buildings without thinking of historical ones, Kelvin MacLeod said once. Architect is a visual art, and the building speaks for themselves. And where else one can find such beautiful visual arts other than our own motherland, India? Our Indian culture and heritage is our asset, and people across the globe are aware of that. Good evening to one and all present here. Today, we all have gathered here virtually to view the August event under the aegis of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, Aurangabad. The Department of History and Ancient Indian Cultural and Aurangabad History Society collaboratively organizes Young History Scholars Lectures. And we have among us a very young, dynamic resource person, Dr. Satvik Malipatil. A MA in History and PhD from Central University of Karnataka, Dr. Satvik has a long list of achievements and participations. To highlight a few, Dr. Satvik has participated in international conference on pre-colonial Deccan, History, Culture and Literature, Central University of Karnataka. He also participated in national workshop on temple architecture and iconography, Mysore University. He has also presented a research paper on temple of Chalukyas in Hunabad Taluka, a study national level seminar on history and culture of Bidar region. Dear Satvik sir, I wholeheartedly welcome you. Also among us is eminent personality, Dr. Beena ma'am, Beena Sengar ma'am. She is assistant professor at Department of History, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, Aurangabad. She is also the founding secretary of Aurangabad History Society. Beena ma'am, I welcome you. I also invite you to please share your views and ideas related to this. Over to you, Beena ma'am.
Thanks a lot, Sujata, for giving such a beautiful opening for this event. It's with great pleasure to introduce a Young History Scholar Lecture Series as a public event under Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Marathwada University's Department of History and Ancient Indian Culture, which will be collaboratively organized with Aurangabad History Society. This is an event which was long overdue. We had a lot of young scholars associated to our Department of History and Ancient Indian Culture of our university. Under that particular auspices, we always wanted to groom and further share the different young ideas which were always there with us. Hence, since last 2 months, we brainstormed with several university students from all over the world. And we decided to have a series of lectures by these young scholars, where they can share their new research findings and also could engage themselves with different university networks of India as well as abroad. Therefore, this Young History Scholar Lecture Series was initiated by our department and with the local history initiative body, Aurangabad History Society. Today's lecture is by young scholar Dr. Satvik Malipatil. Elaborately about his achievements, already Mrs. Roy has told us. Today he will be speaking on Chalukyan temple in Deccan. Therefore, this particular lecture series is not going to be one-time thing. We are not trying to overburden students and even the scholars in the different events. So only once in a month this event will be organized. And every month there will be young scholar either invited or we will be also having a scrutiny committee. So even those students or those young scholars who are interested to share their ideas and achievements with these social networking as well as the online platform, they can always send us their resume and we would definitely screen them so that they can share their findings as well as their research in these public platforms. Due to COVID, we have this thing going on online. But even in future, we would definitely like to invite the scholars in our city and we'll host their talks. And definitely, not only those talks will be shared through the non-virtual platform, but also through the virtual platform through our YouTube channel, which you're already watching us. So I definitely invite all these young scholars, and with all our blessings and good wishes to young scholars, to continue with Young History Scholars Lecture Series. Once again, invite Dr. Satvik Mali Patil and thank him for obliging us to share his ideas with us. And along with us, I also welcome all the distinguished panel members who all are young research scholars working on their PhD topic. Thanks, thanks again to all of you, and with best wishes, over to you, Ms. Roy.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for such a great and valuable platform that you have provided for all the young achievers. The other eminent person with us is Mr. Dhananjay Bhusenge. Sir is an alumni of Department of History from Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Marathwada University. Sir is a PhD research scholar, Center for Diaspora Studies, Central University of Gujarat. He is currently working on Marathi diaspora in Mauritius. I welcome you, sir. Very quickly, I would also like to introduce the other very dynamic personality among us, that is Ms. Ashwini Khandekar. She is PhD, MPhil, Center Gandhian Thought, Center for Gandhian Thoughts and Peace Studies, Central University of Gujarat. Her thesis title is Integration of India and Princely State, a Comparative Study of Junagadh and Hyderabad from 1947 to 1950. I welcome you, ma'am. We also have Mr. Vivek S. Bhadauria, sir, a very young and dynamic person. Sir holds a bachelor's degree in arts from University of Delhi. He has done MA in Medieval Indian History from Department of History and Culture, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. He is currently working on a research area in indigenous modernity in medieval India. I wholeheartedly welcome you, sir. Without waiting any more further, I request Dr. Satvik, sir, to start with his presentation. Over to you, Satvik, sir.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Veena ma'am, for giving me a wonderful opportunity and to be selected as the first participant or a first speaker to be the part of this young scholars group. And shall I start the presentation?
Yeah, please. You can start sharing your PPT with us.
Okay. I hope everybody can see, right?
Yes, we can. We'll just test it on the live, YouTube live as well. Ashwini, can you just update it if it is coming properly in YouTube live? Okay, go ahead,
Ashwini. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Go ahead. Yeah, please proceed, Dr.
Okay. So very warm good evening to everybody. So here I am, Dr. Satvik Mali Patil. So today I'll be dealing with the structural temples of Badami Chalukyas. So starting from this temple architecture. So today we'll be dealing this about the Badami Chalukyas, who ruled from 6th century to 8th century from Badami as a capital. So they built the structural temples, which were built in stones. So they were the pioneers to start the structural temples as a medium of stones. So we'll be dealing about that. First, we'll start with the emergence of structural temples. So here, the rock excavations for creating the cave sanctuaries are found in the Western Deccan from 3rd century BC onwards. But the use of stone for the medium of temples was not unpopular. The Guptas built the stone temples like those of Nacharakuta, Bhumra Shiva temples, Deogar Vishnu temple in Madhya Pradesh, and they laid the foundation of stone structural temple tradition. Between 2nd century BC and 6th century CE, the brick, timber, mortar architectural tradition was strong in peninsular India. So before the stone structural temples, so these were the elements like brick, timber and mortar were used. So that is the reason they perished. So we have only the remains or the dilapidated conditions of temples where we can see the remains of the temple. So the evidences such as the Sannathi, Vadagam, Madhavpur, Banavasi, Gudnapur, and Halsi. So in Deccan, the Badami Chalukyas were the first to use as a stone extensively for structural temples. So while coming to the background of Chalukyas of Badami, we should know that they were the successors, or that they defeated the Kadambas in the Deccan to control the political hegemony of the Deccan. They had the supremacy over the large area of Deccan, comprising of Maharashtra, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, and Karnataka from 543 to 757, with Badami as their capital. Pulakeshi was the first imperial ruler, and later Pulakeshi II expanded the kingdom in all the directions. By the time they became the masters, the land between the two rivers, that is Narmada and Kaveri. By 757, with the demise of Kirtivarman II, and they were defeated by the Rashtrakutas, imperial Rashtrakutas. So that was the end of the great legacy of Chalukyas of Badami. So while coming to the Chalukyan architectural tradition, as I said earlier, they were the pioneers. So Badami Chalukyas were continued the tradition of cave temples as well as, then they were the pioneers of building the temples in the stone as the medium. And the temples were built in reddish sandstone found in plenty in and around the capital, Badami. The temples seen at Badami, Mahakota, Aihole, Pattadakal, Alampur, and lesser known sites. And these temples have the great varieties of plants and forms, and especially with Nagara and Dravida. So while coming to the plans, temple plans, the earlier temples were very simple to elaborate. The small temple or a simple temple had a square Garbhagriha, a Mukhamantapa, while the larger temples had the Garbhagriha with the Pradakshinapatha, Gudamantapa, and Mukhamantapa. The best example for that are Upper Shivalaya and Mahakoteshwara temple, etc. So the later temples have the Garbhagriha, Antarala, Pradakshinapatha, and the larger Gudamantapa, occasionally with entrance from three sides through the Mukhamantapa. Separate Nandi Mantapa or the Prakara and the Prakara, the enclosure wall with the gateways are the good examples for that is Virupaksha temple and Mallikarjuna temple at Pattadakal. The other temples, plans like Gajaprastha, apsidal plan, the best example is Durga temple at Aihole, and also the Shiva temple at Chikkamahakota. The hall type temple, the large square hall accommodating a rectangular Garbhagriha at the rear end of the Mukhamantapa in front. That is the Lord Khan temple at Aihole. So this is the political map of the Badami Chalukyas in the peninsular India. So we can see this is the interface zone where that was the nucleus, the ruling kingdom of this Badami Chalukyas. And this was the interface zone also for the architectural purpose. And here we can see the extreme down south, this is the Dravida, and the extreme up above the Tungabhadra River and Krishna Godavari, that is Nagara. The temple forms. The Chalukyan temples present significant varieties of temple forms. The basic varieties are as follows. The Dravida, the South Indian style temples, Nagara, Northern Indian style temples, Gajaprastha or apsidal type temple, and last, that is Mantapa or the hall type temples. So here I can show you the images of the temple. First, we can see the Dravida. Is my voice and PPT is clear, ma'am?
Perfectly. You're perfectly clear. Not to worry. Go ahead.
Thank you. Because I'm not visible to anybody. So.
Yeah, I understand. Not to worry. It's all clear. Even on live, you're perfectly all right.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
So here we can see the four different varieties of temples, temple forms. The first we can see this is called as a Dravida structure, means a South Indian temple style. Here we can see the Nagara Prasada. This is a Rekha Nagara, or we can also call it as a Kalinga Nagara. Okay, and this is the second type. Here I have shown another temple, another structure of the Kalinga Nagara from the backside. Here the third one is Gajaprastha Akara. This is called as a U-shaped, English alphabet U-shaped, it is elephant back, what we call. So that kind of form. Here the fourth one is a Mandapa type temple. So here we can deal there's some disturbances coming, is it okay?
No, for us there is no disturbance. Go ahead.
Okay.
Maybe I have just not switched off my mic.
So here first we'll deal with Dravida or South Indian temple form. Here we should see the components from bottom to the top. That is Adhisthana, Bhitti, Prastara. The Prastara also has the intermediate talas, which can be observed. And Griva, Shikara, and Stupi. So these are six components, six in parts. So that is why it is called as a Shadvarga, six component, that is called as a Vimana. They have the adjuncts or the architectural members. The shape of the Shikara has also the subforms. If the Shikara is in square on plan, it is called as a Brahmachanda. If it is octagonal in shape, it is Vishnuchanda. While circular, it is Rudrachanda. So you people might getting confused with the terminologies and the things. So I'll make it clear by this image. So what I've spoken here is, this is the Shadvarga, the components from bottom to top. That is six Shadvargas: Adhisthana, Bhitti, Prastara, Griva, Shikara, and Stupi. So here we can see all the six components. So the lowest member of the Shadvarga is Adhisthana, which has the other components like Komuda and Tripatta Komuda, Dharavritta Komuda, Mahapatti, Upana. So these kinds of other components. And second is Bhitti. So the Bhitti starts from the Mahapatti. This is called as a Mahapatti. From here, the Bhitti starts. Even the Bhitti also has some other architectural members, sub-members, that is called as a Kudyastambhas. So these are called as a Kudyastambhas. I hope you are seeing this, my cursor. This is a Kudyastambhas, which also called as a pilasters. So from here, that is Prastara, which is also called as entablature. So here we can see the Hara, the secondary, means other components, the Shala, Kuta, Panjara, and also the Talas, which starts from Prastara. Okay, that's from the roof. And next is the Griva, which is called as a neck of a temple or a human body, what we call, compare that. Neck, that is Griva, and Shikara, this is the Shikara, cupola, and Stupi is missing. I'll show in another slide. Okay, so this is the Stupi. And this is the Guda Mantapa. So this entire superstructure is called as a Vimana. So people get confused. The Shikara, many people think that this entire thing is Shikara. No, this is called as a Vimana. In Dravida terminology, it is called as a Vimana. Okay, so this has a six components, six members. So this entire is Vimana. So the Garbhagriha is placed here inside, beneath this Shikara. And this is the Guda Mantapa, which is called as a hall or assembly hall. This is the thing inside. And this is the Mukha Chatushki or Mukha Mantapa also, where this is the entrance of a temple. And this is also called as a porch in English. I hope you are clear with this image and the terminologies.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here, I was speaking with this Shikara, right? So in my previous slide, I showed the shape of the Shikaras. They have the subform. That is, if it is square, it is Brahmachanda. Octagonal, it is Vishnuchanda. And while circular, it is Rudrachanda. So that we can see in this image. So this is the temple from the Pattadakal, okay, Virupaksha temple. So we can see here, this is the a square based. You can see the square base, four. Okay, so this is called as a Brahmachanda, and this is octagonal in shape. This is called as a Vishnuchanda, and this is a circular. We can see circular, right? We can see the circular in shape. This is called as a Rudrachanda. Many people get confused here because they are also called by Vesara, Dravida, and Nagara. So the proper textual terminologies, Vastu Grantha, says that these are to be called as Brahmachanda, Vishnuchanda, and Rudrachanda. Why it is called? It is very simple that Brahma has four face, right? So it is called as a Brahmachanda, and Vishnu has eight weapons, right? Ashtra. So it is called as
yes, ma'am.
It is eight in number, and Rudrachanda, as we can see the Shivalinga, but is in circular, so it is called as a Rudrachanda as a textual basis. On the textual basis, so this is about the Shadvargas and as well as the Shikara part. So next we move to the Nagara or Northern Indian temple form. The form of a Mula Prasad, that is the proper shrine, defines the Rekha Nagara temple. And the components from bottom to top here also is Pita, Janga, Rekha Shikara, Gala, Amalaka, and Kalasha. So that also we can see here in this next image. So we can see the Pita. Pita is slightly missing with this inside. So we can see the proper Pita here. That is why I have put the another picture. We can see the Pita, which is called Adhisthana in the Dravidian text. Please don't get confused with the terminologies, because Pita is nothing but the Adhisthana, right? You can use a common terminology called as a plinth. Plinth is a common terminology we can use. In Dravidian text, it is Adhisthana. In the Nagara tradition, it is called as a Pita. And here, from here, it is Jangha. It is a wall proper or wall structure. And from here, it is called as a Rekha Shikara. Rekha, that is curvilinear in shape. This is called as a Shikara. Complete thing. Here, it is called as a Shikara. And here, we can see the Amalaka and Kalasha is missing. We can see only the Vedi, the Skanda part. Here we can see the Gala, which is inside, and Amalaka, which is called as an Indian gooseberry. It looks like an Amla. I think you all might have eaten the Amla or seen the Amla. So it resembles like Amla. The ribs we can see on that. So this is like Amla. So it's called as an Amalaka, and Kalasha. It's a pot finial apex. So this, and this also have some other components, like from the, okay, from the Shikara, if you see, we can see the Bhumi Skanda, which we can see here, right? And Talas, we can see, sorry, Latas, which we can see here. This is the Latha. And we can see Karna Amalakas. This is the Amalaka. Karna is nothing but the ears. So at the corner of Shats, so it is called as a Karna Amalaka, which is like a cushion capital, like cushion kind of thing. Okay, so this is the secondary, I mean, other components of Shikara, right? And we can see this is Sukhanasa. It's a proper projection in front. We can see here, which is missing, which is slightly fallen. We can see here. I can show you another slide, it might be there. So this is called as a Sukhanasa, which is a proper Nagara element. Okay, so it's a proper Nagara element, Sukhanasa, which starts from the Prastara. That is what I say, starts from the Rekha Shikara. Okay, so this is Amalaka, what we have seen here. This is Amalaka, which has just fallen in the Pattadakal. I have taken the pic. And here we can see the flag post. We can see, I think you might have seen, you all can see this hole inside. So here it is made for the flag to be posted there with their respective emblems and all. Here it is there. But in Dravidian text, there is a separate, what do you say, Dvajastambha or Dvajamana in the Dravidian text. But here there is no Dvajastambha or Dvajamana. So they place the flag post here on the Amalaka. So this is the other view of this Galganatha temple, which I have shown earlier. And this is the Pita, what I have shown here. This I was this part. I have taken another pick, close pick. This is called as a Tulapita, which is a very main or a prime feature in the Pita of the Nagara tradition. This one, the dental like blocks, which can be seen. Okay, I hope you are clear. The Gajaprista is the next, third variety, third type. So Gajaprista or apsidal on plan, literally means it is like an elephant's back, or it is a U-shaped. So if you see this structure, it is like a U-shape, right? You can see the U-shaped. And it's called as an apsidal. Apsidal means half U or a semicircle kind of thing. So this we can see here. And above that, we can see the Rekha Nagara or the North Indian superstructure. The best example is Durga Temple at Aihole. So this is the best. You can see the Amalaka has fallen here, maybe 50, 70 years ago, because I have seen rarest pictures from the Cambridge University as well. Even that point of period also, the Amalaka was not there. So it has fallen long ago. And this is the thing. So while explaining this ground plan of this Gajaprista, even the Garbhagraha is also Gajaprista. There are many types of Garbhagraha. Like it might be rectangular in shape, Garbhagraha, square in shape, or Gajaprista in shape, or Ayata Vritta, what we call, or Vrittayata, what we call. So these type of Garbhagrahas are there, but we see very generally we see the square and rectangular Garbhagraha. Very rare instance we find this type of Gajaprista, Garbhagraha. And here next is Mantapa or a hall type, temple or a style. So Garbhagraha is accommodated at the rear end with a large hall. So this is the entire structure. We can see the temple here. This is the entire structure, which is rectangular, or this is a square. But here, Garbhagraha is in rectangular at the rear end, right? And the exterior, it looks like a mantapa or a hall type. So in the modern days, what I can compare or what I can say is, for your imagination, like conviction halls or Kalyana Mantapa in the modern days. So it resembles in such a manner. So we can't say it is a secular. It might be for the any religious, means like any religious like cradle ceremony or jatras or any other things. So any ritualistic or religious purpose it might have served, because many scholars say that this Garbhagraha was not the original Garbhagraha. Original image was installed in between here at the center, so that the people come and look around from the four sides. So later it was installed here. And here we can see the large Jalandharas. Jalandharas are nothing but the windows. So here we can see the large three Jalandharas. So this is the Jalandharas. And backside also we can see. And this is the square, Mantapa hall. And we can see the four pillars. It's a porch or a Mukha Mantapa. And this is the thing where we can see the Kakshasana. The backrest, what we call backrest, or in the modern terminology, I can compare with the sofa set, what we generally have in everybody's home, what I call, I think. So this is a backrest when the devotees come and they just stand. And there is also a tradition in temple that we go to the temple and we don't come just like that. We sit for some moment. We close the eyes when we feel very peace. So we sit for the few moments or few minutes. So that is the reason why this Kakshasana is also made. So it's a backrest. The people go and sit. And scholars believe that it is from the northern tradition. That is a Nagara architecture. So that has come and inculcated from the northern tradition. And here we can also see a small structure. It's not, we can't call it a superstructure. It's a small structure. Initially, it was worshipped and now it is not in worship. We have a Surya deity installed there, so that these kinds of structures are made when the superstructures are not there. The intention is very simple, that nobody should go above the roof and nobody should walk above the Garbhagriha. That is the main basic intention of making the superstructure or any small shrines or a structure over the Garbhagriha. That's the main thing, because nobody should walk on that. And we have the, the three types of installing the deity, like sitting posture, standing posture, and sleeping posture. That is Sthanaka and Asina and Shayana. So these are the things where according to that, the Garbhagriha is placed or the idol is placed. So over that, this a small structure is made so that nobody should walk or like bird, or they should not do some dirty on that. So that is the reason why this small structure is made. So this is a replica of that made in wooden. This is the Larkhan temple, what we have seen. And this is the Ayole Durga temple. We can see the stairs here. We can see the Adhisthana. We can see the corridors, right? And we can see this slant roof. We can see the stone hoods, right? So this is the best we can see here. Exactly here, this is the way the temple is made, right? So that this was the initial days where the Chalukyas of Badami made the structural temples. So they were doing some experiments and they didn't have that experience. So they have placed some stone hoods, which was just a replica of wooden architecture, what we can see, so that the water should not go inside, right? Like waterproofing kind of thing. So this is just slant over that the structure is made. Okay. So while coming to the simple Dravidian structures, so this is a simple Dravidian temple near the Ravalfadi cave, which belongs to the 6th century Ayhole. So here we can see the Shadvargas, right? I have said that's a simple to elaborate plan. So this is very simple. We can see Adhisthana with the Kapota and Bhitti. If you're familiar with the terminologies, this is the Bhitti or a wall proper. And from here, we can see the Prastara. This is Gala, which is neck, which is not that properly shown, but they tried to make, because we can analyze that this is the Gala and this is the Brahmachanda, Shikhara, but Stupi is missing here. And from here, we can see the porch, which is called as a Mukha Chatushki or a Mukha Mandapa. A very small temple or a small shrine. It is also like a small sub-shrine, it looks like. And we can see the Hasti Hasta. These are called as a Hasti Hasta, a trunk of an elephant, what we call in the modern days, like grill, what we can stairs, we can keep the hand and go, right? So this was the concept, trunk of an elephant, that elephant welcomes you to the temple kind of thing. So these are stairs, Hasti Hasta. So this is a very simple structure, a simple and small shrine. So coming to this another shrine, this is the Malagithi Shivalaya temple, which is about built in 625 CE. So here also we can see the stone hoods. Still the things are going on. Okay, still the things are going on. They're doing some experiments. So we can see the development of architecture. The development of architecture from a small shrine to the larger shrine, right? So you can see the complete Shadvarga, right? So this is a temple. So this was a temple, right? This was the structure which I have shown. So that is the structure here. This is a structure. This is the same temple, Malagithi Shivalaya temple. So you can see the upper aerial view kind of thing. So this is the porch, okay? Mukha Chatushki and Guda Mantapa and Vimana. This we have seen. From front view, we can see the hefty pillars. This is only a very very simple shaft and potika, corbel. Very simple shaft with the potikas. Okay, this Adhara potika, just for utilitarian purpose, right? And from inside, if you see the grit, the heftiness of the pillar, so hefty they are, so big they are. Okay, and we can see the Tarangapothikas. These are called as the Tarangapothikas, and this is pillars which not much distance, they are very closely made. And Uttara, we can see here the Bheem. You can see here the Uttara is called as a Bheem. So this is the elaborate structure, and this is another structure, Aihole Meghuthi temple, Jina temple, where we can see the Mandapa type of temple. This temple has come into existence around 634, because we can see the Aihole inscription, the Prashasti, where we can come across the details where the Dakshinapati and the Uttarapati, that is the Pulakeshi II, defeated the Uttarapateshwara. They got the name after defeating this. So the Pulakeshi II defeated the Harshavardhana, which is recorded in the Aihole inscription, Prashasti. Right? And this was done by the Ravikirti, might be the court poet. So this is here, which is placed, and they have given a slant there because of waterproofing or sun roof, that kind of thing. So we can read the Prashasti here, it is placed. And this temple has undergone many changes from time to time. So initially it was a very small hall kind of thing. So later additions were made. These all are the later additions. We can see the color, and we can see the structure right here. So this is a later addition. For the course of a time, they made the later additions. Then it also has some adhisthana, a proper recess kala, and patti with the nasi, and bitti and prastara. So this is development, slowly the development of architecture in mantapa hall also, type also. And this is another temple. We can see the development of Dravidian structure. Here we can see the Mahakoteshwara temple at Mahakota. This temple also had undergone many changes in course of time. And by looking at the structure, we can analyze that, right? We can see the Ratha offshoots. So this is the offshoot. This Karanas and offshoots. So this makes the, wall or a shrine to be very fit and strong. This intention is only to make a wall strong, and decorative purpose also, it looks nice without any soberness, without any plain. So this is the Ratha offsets on the Garbhagraha. And we can see the Sandhara. Sandhara is thing, it's called as a circumambulatory, where Pradakshana Patha, where we can take the circumambulation around the Garbhagudi or Garbhagraha. Okay. So this is Sandhara. If this is not there, it is called as a Nirandhara. So people have to come outside and take the circumambulation, right? So this is called as a Sandhara, Pradakshana Patha or circumambulation is taken place within the temple, okay? Within the temple. So this is a common thing in the Badami Chalukyan era. Almost all the temples have the Sandhara. The thing is that if the Sandhara temples are made, there are two purposes. One, for the royal queens and kings, they should not feel a defensive or offensive kind of thing. They'll come inside and they'll get the proper treatment, because without any hesitation, without any fear, they can sit and they can take the Pradakshana Patha inside circumambulation. Another thing, the superstructures, which we can see here, see the superstructures, is very hefty. So to have that pressure, to have that shikara balancing, okay, that is done only if Sandhara temple is there, because the girth of the wall varies from 3 feet to 5 feet also. So entire thing is balanced on the Garbhagraha, the Mula Prasada itself. So it needs a strength. It needs a very girth and strength. So that is the reason why they also make the Sandhara temple. Okay. And this is the Guda Mantapa with the four pillars. And here also we can see the offsets. And this is the later addition with the porch and all, and the Nandi Mantapa. So this is the later additions, what we can see. So next is Hauchamali Gudi at 7th century it is. So this is the Nagaras tradition temple where we can see the Pita, Janga and Rekha Shikara, right? The Amalaka and the Kalasha is missing here. So we can see here the Sukhanasa. Sukhanasa we can see here. And here there is a Nataraja. There's always, there will be always an image here. If I can zoom it here, I can slightly see. The picture is not so clear. Here there will be always an image of Nataraja or any other the image which is enshrined in the temple. Okay. So by that we can analyze that there will be a Shivalinga or a Shiva image inside, installed. And we can see the stone hoods here also. And we can see the long stays, Hasti Hasta. And we can see the Kakshasana. We can see the Purna Kumbha here at the exterior wall of the Kakshasana. The exterior wall in the sense, the face here. And the Kakshasana we can sit there. And this is the first incident instance where we can see the Antarala. The Antarala is a thing where we can see the gap or a space that's called as a vestibule between the what is the Garbhagraha and Guda Mandapa. So here is the first instance, where we can see the Antarala. Now, later time in the Rashtrakuta period, they have made a Jalandhara so that we can't really see that, but we should go and analyze that we can see the Antarala, which is the first instance. Sorry. And well, coming to the developments of Dravidian temple, later phase, the Antarala is introduced, that what I said, between the Garbhagraha and Guda Mandapa. That I'll show in the, ground plan later. Well-defined edicular arrangements with Kuta, Shala and Panjara. Decorative stories with square, octagonal and circular Shikhara, which I've shown in earlier, the Shikhara part. The larger complexes, separate Nandi Mantapa, Prakara, Parivaralaya, shrines of Dravidian forms around with gateways. So this I'll show in the ground plan as well. So incorporation of northern style components like Sukhanasa, Sukhanasi and Kakshasana in the later phase temples. And wall accommodating relief images of various gods and goddesses. So here, whenever a king goes to the expedition or military campaign, he'll not go alone. In the sense, he'll take the entire crew. For example, he'll take the stapatis as well. So when the stapatis went to Kalinga, Odisha, or the Malwa expedition, so they also bring the very good number of stapatis, the talented stapatis, and they take the stapatis from there and place, and they do the temple activity in their own region. And they, while carrying the stapatis also see the architectural marvelous and the beauty of that region, and they start inculcating in their own region, in the native region. So that is how the tradition also takes place, right? And now still we can see the, idlis and dosas in the Delhi, right? And we can also see the pulka and parotas in Bangalore. So there's exchange of how it is done by the cultural tradition exchange. So while exchange in the culture and tradition, we can get these kinds of culmination. In the same manner, so the composite culture, the culture which was seen in the Malwa and Kalinga region, so they inculcated. So that is why we can see the Sukhanasa and Sukhanasi, which I've shown in the earlier structures. I can show once again. Okay, so this is a Sukhanasa. And Sukhanasi is that, it is nothing but the Antarala. Antarala is also called as Sukhanasi, if this Sukhanasa is there. Right? Antarala is a term which is used for Dravidian text, Dravidian temple. And Sukhanasi is used for the Nagara. Okay, so this is, and Kakshasana. So these three things which are inculcated, which are brought from the northern, it is believed that it is brought from the northern, Nagara temples. Okay, so here next is the Sangameshwara temple. This is the proper Dravidian temple, which is constructed by Vijayaditya and other king, which is incomplete because some of the images are not properly made. So this is an incomplete temple, but still we can see the properly, we can see the Adhisthana, we can see the Bhitti, we can see the Prastara, Shala, Kuta, Panjara, and Talas, and Griva, we can see the proper Griva, and Shikara, and Stupi in the pot, we can see here. So this is a proper thing, right? And we can see the Guda Mantapa inside, we can see the porch with the hall, with the pillar, which is opened by all the three sides, right? But here we cannot see the Kakshasana. Still, it is not being made. So it depends upon the sthapatis and all. We can't question why it is not made, why it is made. So it's all about the independent or the liberty given to the sthapatis. They have their own imagination. So everything we can't guess and we can't get from the textual evidences, right? It is all about their imagination, their liberty given to the sthapatis. And this is the Virupaksha temple, the Pattadakal. This might be the second phase of the Badami Chalukyas or the declining of Badami Chalukyan era. So this is the Virupaksha temple, which has a three entrance, one, two, and other side. So we have the three entrances. We can see the proper Adhisthana, Bhitti, Prastara, and Shikara here. And we can see the Kakshasana as well. And this Hastihasta is later inclusion by the ESI, I guess. And this is the thing, right? The Kapota, very well Kapota is carved. So Kakshasana, right? Here we can see, yes, this is the other picture of that Virupaksha temple. So we can see the Sukhanasa. The earlier picture, it was not clear. So we can see the proper Sukhanasa from here, Prastara, right? And here we can see inside, it will be a Sukhanasi. It's an antechamber or a vestibule. It's a pathway towards the, which connects, it's an intermediate space, which connects the Guda Mantapa. There's a Guda Mantapa to the Antarada, Garbhagra. Okay. So this is the thing, this is the inclusion. That's what I said. The sthapatis which came from the other parts, or the sthapatis which have went and came back, saw and they inculcated few components which looks like temple more beautiful and more marvelous. So this Sukhanasa, inside is Sukhanasa. So here it is a proper ground plan, which are most elaborate and decorative with all the components. So starting from Garbhagraha, we can see the Garbhagraha here, and we can see the Sandhara, right? We can see the Sandhara here. What I said, Sandhara is a circumambulatory, where you can see the Pradakshana. We can go around the Pradakshana, around the Garbhagraha. We can see here a sub-shrine, and this is the Guda Mantapa, where we can see the three entrances, one, two, and three, right? This is the main entrance. This is two are the other entrances. So it is believed that the three entrances are made because one is because of population, and the population was also increasing. And so it will be one entrance will be a very rigid thing or a very the people rush. So it will be a very tedious job for the other temple activities to come. So for that purpose, they have made the three entrances. And it is also believed that a southern entrance is also given for the royal king and queens, and also for the sthapatis and the Mahamandaleshwara kind of thing, right? For them, because all the activities which was any activity in the ancient period was attached to the temples. It might be any ritual, it might be any education centers, Ghatikasthana, or how do you say, exactly, Ghatikasthana and all. So these were attached to the temples. So the teacher and the preacher was given the more that alike people were given that status. For that reason, that like we call as a VIP, how do you say, entrance or VVIP entrance. So in the same manner, that was the entrance also given for the other people. And here we can see the, what do you say, Hasti Hasta. And this is the separate Nandi Mantapa. Separate Nandi Mantapa. It's a very beautiful Nandi Mantapa. And here we can see the sub shrines. We can see the Parivaralayas are placed here. For example, the Ashtadikpalakas or Dwarapalakas and Saptamatrikas. If the Vishnu shrine is there, we can see the other forms of Vishnu, the avatars of Vishnu. And Shiva, the other forms of Shiva. So these are the Ganesha, Parvati, Durga. So all these kinds of sub-shrines are, what do you say, made, or the Parivaras are installed in the sub-shrines here in the Prakara. So this called as a, this wall is called as a Prakara, and this is the main entrance of the temple. Okay. So this is the Papanatha temple. So this is a very beautiful example where we can see the culmination of both the Dravida and Nagara components. So it's a mixed medium where you can see till Prastara, right? It is Dravida. The elements, we can see the Kostas, this Mukha Mantapa kind of thing, and we can see the proper Adhisthana and what do you say, pilasters, what I have said, pilasters. And here, from here, we can see the Rekha Nagara. Rekha Nagara Shikara. So this is a proper culmination of both Nagara as well as Dravida component. So it is incomplete if we don't speak about the sculptures to the temple, because it is associated with the part and integral part of our temple. So sculptures, we can see the relief sculptures on the temple, and the wide varieties of wide themes of various sportive forms of Vishnu and Shiva, and Puranic and epic narrative panels of Mahabharata, Ramayana, Puranas and Panchatantra, right? So we can see these kinds of relief sculptures and narrative panels in the temples, on the wall of our temples. So here, the first image I'm showing is Surya. It is on the Virupaksha temple, the Surya on the ceiling, Surya with his, all the attributes, with the seven horses, right, with the seven horses, and we can see the he's carrying the two lotus. Okay, that's a morphology, that's a how we can identify the Surya, with the seven horse, with the two lotus, right? So this is a very beautiful, marvelous ceiling. We should appreciate the sculptor because it is totally upward. He has carved very meticulously. And he has taken lots of pain, I guess, because intricacy of carving in that stage and the roof is very difficult. So really, we should appreciate, hats off to the Sthapati who has carved these kinds of ceilings. And this is a very beautiful Mahishamardini Durga, which is placed in the sub-shrine. I have shown here this sub-shrine. Okay, here it is placed, Durga. Very beautiful. And next is Vishnu forms we can see. The Krishna in the Govardhana, lifting the Govardhana Parvata. And we can see the, what is a small elephant, cows and people. All right. And we can see the turban of the Krishna. We can see the mount in the hill, which is carrying. Okay. So this is about the Krishna lifting the Govardhana. It is on the Adhisthana thing. And we can see the Narasimha killing the Hiranyakashipu. And we can see the Prahlada, who was caught very scared, looking at the, what is a posture, looking at this Narasimha, because the universe or the world hasn't seen such a person with a human body and with a lion face. So he really got scared, killing his father and tearing this stomach, okay, with the nails. So you can see the fears of what is it, Prahlada. And the next is Trivikrama, where we can see the one leg goes to the universe, the solar system. The beautiful image here, and we can see the Jambavanta. Is a Jambavanta, and we can see the. But here it is not shown in Badami cave temples. It is beautiful Trivikrama Vamana Avatara, where we can see the Brahma is washing the feet of Vishnu Trivikrama, and the Bali and Shukracharya are here. We can see here. And the Shukracharya is holding the Bali. What you're doing that? So it's a beautiful sculpture. Here also they have, the sculptor has made a very good attempt. We can see the iconometry, how he has made, how he has composed the complete, sculpture within that space. And next is a Shiva form. First we can see here a Sthanaka Shiva, very standing with the Samabhanga. Especially in posture, we can see the Samabhanga, Dvibhanga, Tribhanga, Atibhanga. So here is a Sthanaka Shiva with a pleasant face, with a Trishula and a Sarpa, with their other, Ganas. And here we can see the Natesha doing the dance on the Apasmara. Okay, Dhamana, Apasmarana Dhamana, what we call. He's dancing on that. So that is the Apasmara is nothing but the darkness. He's removing the darkness from inside and doing, Dhamana, is killing that darkness. It symbolically it means that. And Lingodbhava, we can see here the Shiva is coming out of the Linga. As you all know that there was a competition between the greatness, the proud feeling that between the Vishnu and Brahma, who is greater? I'm the greater, or you are the greater. So in between the the Linga comes in between them, and there was a competition on that story is there. So between that, this Lingodbhava is made. The Shiva comes in front, in between that. It's a very beautiful sculpture. And next is narrative panels of Ramayana. We can see the Kumbhakarna. We can see the elephants. Okay, we all have seen the Valmiki Ramayana or Ramanan Sagar's Ramayana, how we can, the Kumbhakarna is shown in the very massive structure, right? I think you got the picture of that. So just we can imagine that here, the Kumbhakarna is nicely sleeping because of the boon which he got from the Brahma. Like 6 months you can sleep, 6 months you can be. So everybody are trying to wake him up for the war, okay, on the orders of Ravana. So all are trying to make, you can see the instruments. We can see this instrument. We can see the here instruments. So some are dilapidated. So the elephants are also came here to wake him up. Okay. So this is a thing. The small panel, the relief sculpture at the bottom, at the Adhisthana part. So here on the wall, we can see the Ravana, this Garuda, what we call Ravana killing I'll get back to that. I'm not recalling that word. Okay. So Ravana, when Sita, Ravana was capturing or taking the Sita. So Jatayu. Okay. So Jatayu. The war, the small casual battle between the Jatayu and Ravana. So he was stopping the Ravana to taking the Mata Sita, and just a small battle where the Ravana killed with a Chandrahasa to the Jatayu, and we can see the Jatayu falling here, right? In the wing and on the sky we can see with the Pushpaka Vimana he's taking the Sita. And we can see here the Vali Sugriva battle, where you can see it is dilapidated, it is not properly seen, where the Rama, Sugriva is showing the back so that he can beat the Bali, so with the arrow. So this thing is shown here, the Malla Yuddha, what we can call that thing. And we can see here the Rishvantika Shiva, very beautiful, images, sculptures on the Aihole temple, Durga temple, Vrishabhantika Shiva, where the Shiva goes on a ride on a Vrishabha, that is Nandi, at the marriage point of period or any point of period. So he just hands, casually makes the hand on the Nandi with his other attributes. Okay, as we can see the Gana standing here. And we can see here the Mahishamardini, very ostentatious image and very beautiful image. When we recall the Durga temple, we see that Mahishamardini image everywhere. And we can also see the Gajaprastha. So the two things immediately pricks in your mind, that's the Mahishamardini image. See the slenderness of the image and see the attributes, how the architect has made. We can see the Trishula, we can see the chakra, we can see the shankha, we can see the bell, we can see the bull, the Mahisha, and see, we can see this lion. So few scholars like Professor Padigar says that these are the Malwa. Okay, these are the sculptures came from the Malwa. So this resembles like Malwa sculptures. So when the Pulakeshi II went to the Narmada expedition, what I've said earlier, so he might have bought the stapatis from the Malwa. So it more or less, it looks like a Malwa impact on these images, right? And this is another sculpture of Ravana, where it is the highest devotion to the worshipper, that is Shiva. So he has lifted entire Kailasa. That's the highest, that's the extent of zenith of devotion he is showing towards his Lord. And also Garva also, what we call. Okay, so this is that facing. We can see the many hands. Maybe the sculpture did not get the proper, space, which we can see here properly. He have made the things, attributes, and he's holding the things. But here it is not shown properly. But we should really appreciate the thing, how he has taken the every iconometry and standing posture and the head, the Kirita, and also the Shiva and Parvati. So Shiva and Parvati, we can see she's just afraid of that. What's going on in the Kailasa? The entire Kailasa is shaking. So she's just sitting like that and like asking or requesting Shiva, what's going on here. So that's the thing. Just we should sit and we should observe the sculpture. It speaks, actually. The sculpture speaks to us. Just we should not glance and go. We should just sit and observe the things. The very beautiful, meticulously the carvings have been done. Each and everything has a meaning. That's the beauty of the Indian architectural tradition, culture. So this is that. And this is the Tripurusha, Brahma, Shiva and Vishnu. It's a small relief. And we can see another, Nataraja, Natesha, what we call. He's dancing on the Apasmara. We can see the Parvati and the Naga. And we can see the Trishula and Nandi. So he's doing the dancing posture. So this about the Natesha or Nataraja. So this is about the images and sculptures about the Badami Chalukyas, and which wouldn't have been completed without this beautiful, marvelous sculptures. And at last, I have created this thing that to study the temples, we should observe a lot and analyze a lot, travel a lot and read a lot. And thank you, everybody, because I do, we should all do this. Without doing this, without studying a temple, if you want to study this temple, we should go and observe what I said, and we should analyze why this attribute is there, why this morphology is there, why this kirita is there, why this avatara has placed here, right? And we should travel a lot. Sitting at the in front of the internet, we can't do the search the things and photographs, and we can't analyze. We should go and see the with our eyes. And that's what we feel, our culture, with tradition, we should touch and we should see. It really touches our heart also, right? And read a lot. Definitely, there are very good books, and we should read a lot so that we can get the more knowledge from that. We will get the wisdom out of that. So I really what do you say? And I forgot to put the sources, references from where I've taken. I have taken many many things from internet sources, from Padigar's lecture and my guru Manoj Gundana's lectures and personal talks with him. So I really sincerely thank the both the scholars who always guide me to speak, to read a lot, to travel a lot, to analyze a lot. So I thank both the scholars on this behalf, and I read many books on internet sources which I have taken. And this is all about the structural temples of Badami Chalukyas. So that's the thing. If you have any doubts, please.
Thanks a lot, Sathwe. I ask now Sujata to please take over. Meanwhile, I'll just ask you to please close the presentation for a while so that Q&A session could begin. Sujata, now over to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for such an in-depth insight on the history of architectural temples of Chalukyan dynasty in Deccan. Your knowledge and interest on this topic is highly commendable. You have provided us not only with valuable information, but has also ignited the curiosity and asked to know more about this. So I now call upon Ms. Tejaswini Khandekar, ma'am, and Vivek sir to get into the next segment.
Okay.
Whatever I have said, it is just the ice tip of an iceberg. Just very, very micro level. It's the very micro level what I said. It is not even the introduction of a temple architecture. There are many things to be covered, and I have covered a very, very micro level. So that's the thing I want to say. There are many things to be covered.
Sure. I think one needs a lifetime to study all this knowledge. Just study.
Definitely.
Okay. So now I call upon Ms. Ashwini, ma'am, and Vivek, sir, for our next segment of question and answer round. Over to you, ma'am, and Vivek, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Sujata.
Vivek, will you start with a question so that Ashwini can then take over? Vivek, will you will you begin with the questions now?
Yeah, sure. First of all, your presentation is amazing, wonderful. Bahut hi zyada maza aaya.
Thank you.
My question is, according to Adam Hardy, नागर और द्रविन उसकी अपनी लैंग्वेज है, यू नो, नागर एंड बेसर एंड, बट अकॉर्डिंग टू हिम उनको एक प्रॉपर बॉक्स नहीं रखा जा सकता, लाइक इसमें प्रॉपर नागर या द्रविन नहीं कह सकते, इनके अपने स्पेशल फीचर्स है, रीजनल फीचर्स है.
One second, I'm not able to hear the voice, it's breaking somewhere. I don't know.
What we'll do, let him just speak the question first because I am able to hear him properly. Sure. So if required, I'll do the interpretation.
I can hear you. I can hear you properly.
Yeah. So if there would be any such thing, I'll repeat the question on his behalf. But he's asking a very important question. Let him ask.
Okay.
Yeah, please, Vivek. Continue with Adam Hardy's explanations.
Yeah. According to Adam Hardy's, नागर और द्रविन की जो आर्किटेक्चर उनकी एक रीजनल एक फॉर्म्स है एक्चुअली आर्किटेक्चर है उसको हम नागर या बेसर या द्रविन आर्किटेक्चर के फॉर्म में नहीं देख सकते हैं. अगर हम ऐसा करते हैं तो बेसिकली हम उनकी जो रीजनल फीचर्स हैं रीजनल कल्चर फीचर्स हम उनको प्रॉपर तरीके से नज़रअंदाज करते हैं. माई क्वेश्चन इज डू यू एग्री विद दिस आर्ग्यूमेंट.
It is half clear for me. Please, Abhinavam, please.
With permission of Vivek, I can just explain it to him. Actually, he's quoting the definitions and explanation of Adam Hardy. What Vivek says that Adam Hardy says that we cannot both Dravida and Nagara architectural styles have their own language and their own linguistic expressions. And we cannot say that Dravida and Nagara style is wholeheartedly culminated in these architectural style of Ayol temple or Chalukyan temples. They have their own regional expressions. So how far do you agree to it and how will you explain to this concept?
Yeah, partially I can agree for that because nowhere in our Vastu Granthas it is said that it is a Dravidian text or a Nagara text, right? So if it comes to Mayamata or Manasara or Shilparatna Kosha or any Samarangana Sutradhara, we cannot say this is the Dravidian text or this is the Dravida or a Nagara word is used there. It is only on the basis of the Amalaka or the Rekha Shikara or Shala Kuta Panjara or the Bhitti or the other architectural elements, on that we bifurcate. The Sthapatis on that point of period, on 6th to 7th century, 8th century, 10th century, they never had a thinking that, okay, we are constructing a Nagara temple, we are constructing a Dravida temple, or we are composing the temple and they're making. They didn't have that thing in their mind, right? They started constructing a temple and later we, like the British scholars and the modern scholars, we have bifurcated, we have made a separate temple architecture in the archaeology, and we bifurcated that it's a Nagara, Vesara, Dravida or other sites. But those, that point of period, they didn't have that imagination or that concept of, okay, this is Dravida, this is Nagara, that kind of thing. They just started experimentation on the things according to that, their experience, their knowledge or the Vastu texts which were prevalent at that point of period. And coming to the regional variations, definitely there is a regional variation where we can see the amalgamation of their ritualistic part or their own architectural adjuncts. What I can call that as the liberties given to the Sthapatis, the liberty given
for Ashtanga Vimana in Deccan.
Ashtanga Vimana in Deccan. I don't think so, ma'am. As per my knowledge is concerned, Ashtanga Vimana, because they, what I said, they have started the experimentation with the stone. So we can see that Tritala, Panchatala Vimana, Ashtanga is, I don't think so. As per my knowledge is concerned, Ashtanga Vimana is not there.
By the Chalukyan thing. Another question he asked is, whether the larger constructions in phase two is the result of growing military power of the Badami Chalukyas?
We can't say it's military. It's all about the interest of a king. If the king is very interested and he got a very good land and a very good sthapatis, so definitely he'll make a very good temple, a larger temple. And definitely it makes we can correlate to the military achievements, because when we do the military, conquest, then only we can get the funding or we can get the things, right? We can get plunder and we can get the things. So on behalf of that also, we can see, partially we can say yes, we can't completely deny on that. On that also, yes, the larger temples and complexes are made, because the best example is Virupaksha temple. So we can see the victory pillars, where we can see the when the kings go and gain the victory over the other parts. Okay, they come and celebrate on the celebration occasion. They'll construct the temple. Yes.
Perfect. Thank you. That was a very good question. Well answered. Thank you, Sattvik. I would further now request Ashwini and Vivek and Sujata, of course. If you have any further questions, please go ahead. I would definitely like young scholars to come up with their queries and their...
I love questions. Please ask.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, please, Vivek, go ahead.
Yeah. According to some scholars like G.N. Jha, वो कहते हैं कि इस टाइम हम देखते हैं बहुत सारे टेंपल इमर्ज हो रहे हैं. You know very well. जो इमर्जेंस को एक लैंडलॉर्डिज्म की तौर पे देखते हैं, मतलब इस म्यूचुअल रिलेशनशिप के तौर पे देखते हैं, जिसको रिलेशनशिप बोला जा सकता है. तो डू यू एग्री दिस आर्ग्यूमेंट?
Mr. Singh, I'm really sorry. I'm not able to
no
hear
problem. I am able to hear him very well. So I'll interpret on his behalf. So he's saying that according to Professor D.N. Jha, right? Right, Vivek?
Yeah. Yeah.
So according to Professor D.N. Jha, he says that from the 6th century onwards till the 12th century, there is a growth of feudal landlordism, and the major patrons for such kinds of temples throughout India are these feudal lords. So there is a very strong connection between landlordism and the temple architecture. So does the Chalukyan temples also define the similar kind of relationship? And what is the social construct behind these temples?
Yeah.
What is
yeah.
the social role played by these temples? Like how the society is taking... benefiting or how the social life is evolving around these temples. Is there any manifestation on that? Because even in the sculptures, if you'll see how well the life of the contemporary time is depicted. So these are certain, it's actually a cultural nuisance which we have to understand of those times. I hope, Vivek, I could convey the message. Yeah, sure. Please go ahead.
I'll really enjoy answering this. I'll try to answer this because it's a very good question, what I say. First, coming to the social concept, we can see from the as old as the initial talk I have, sentence I have said that the Indian temples are as old as the culture. Okay. So the Indian culture, we have the Purusha Suktas, that is the Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha. Right, so that we can see on the temple wall, in the temple, everything, whatever we see in the social activity, which are already mentioned, which is already there in temple, from the birth till death, everything is associated to the temple. From the cradle ceremony, what I said, from the cradle ceremony to the pindadana, everything is done with the association of the temple. Okay, for example, I have given the Purusha Sukta, dharma. What is dharma? We should do our duty with dharma, right? With the righteousness. And from that, what we gain, that is artha. Artha is economy. Okay, that's the economy. From that economy itself, we should lead a life. Okay, and on that economy also, 1/6 of the part which goes to the king. Okay, that also goes to the temple. So from that. Dharma, we get the economy. From the economy, we should also be giving to the temple, which is associated to that. And that is next is Kama, that is the pleasure or the desire. So the Khajuraho temples is the best example for that. And in my area also, I have got a very beautiful erotic sculptures and beautiful images. So that means if you see the images, normally, generally, it will be on the forehead, so that like life size. Not life size images, I mean, where we can see and stand the images of erotic sculpture. That is the desire, that is Kama. So that we can see and understand that, okay, this kind of life we should enjoy. This kind of life we should possess. Because many people doesn't, this is in this technology, 21st century, we get all kinds of access. Okay, we get all kinds of access to get the pleasure, get the how to start the life and pornography is there and those things are there. But at that point of period, we didn't have that. So for better understanding for the newly married couples, and it is shown that this is the thing how you should start the life journey, your marital life. And it is also shown that if you are indulged with two women, there is a symbol called as a scorpion or snake. It symbolizes that it is very dangerous. You should not indulge in the intercourse or that thing with the other woman. It is clearly mentioned. Okay, so I'm giving a very small example which is relevant to everybody. We should know that, because many Western scholars or many people that why this all erotic sculptures or what these kinds of things are drawn in the temple. It shows that we should see and we should observe, we should start our marital life according to this. Then this is the third path. Next path is that moksha. Then we'll go, we'll do circumambulation, right? We should do circumambulation. We could see all the things, right? How to do the things and all. And then we'll go into inside the temple. Inside the temple, we don't have any kinds of sculptures, right? That is the moksha. After doing all these things, dharma, artha, kama, we should do the penance or moksha, okay? So we should get the liberation. We should go and sit the meditation and we should do the other, what is the next activity. So that is what we can call to the, the Brahmacharya, the Vanaprastha, this, the things were there, right? In our olden times. So that is also related to this. So, and also, and next point is that if you see the outer wall of a temple, we'll see the elephants at the beneath, at the ground level. It means that it has the strength and stability. It has the strength and stability to bear the load of entire temple, elephant. Above that, we have the horse. We have the military achievements. We can see the military achievements on the panels. Especially this we can see in the Hoysala temple architecture. Especially because they had the large, very large Adhisthana, and that each panel shows in different manners how the life, how the dharma, artha, kama, moksha, which is entirely shown in the all the postures with all the panels, very detailed. Okay, and coming to the social activity also, while entering the main Garbhagriha or the other entrance of the temple, there is called as a Dwara Shakha, the door jams. On that also, it is shown that I have discovered one thing, that the plow, a person is taking the plow on his shoulders and going. And another upper beam, it is shown with the plowing the seeds. So there's a social activity. Okay. And we can see the small children with the toys. So that all shows this social activity at that point of period in 6th, 7th or 8th century. So this all, everything is related to a temple. There was nothing like a secular. Everything is related to temple. You just name it, it is there in temple activity. Okay.
Yeah, but what about feudal agriculture relationship?
Definitely feudal agriculture relationship is there. That's what I said. Whatever you grow, you should be giving 1/6 or 1/10 of that point of period of what the code of conduct or rules or regulations which were made by the king, according to the prashasti or that inscription. So they have to give, and everybody has to go. Even today also in the villages, if you observe, if the person lies, if the person cheat, if the person do robbery, theft, he'll go, they'll directly take that person to the temple and they'll say, okay, promise in front of the God, promise in front of the, God, and put the hand on your children so that I didn't do that. That's a promising. What we call in the local language, ane, we do that. So it means that we give that respect, we fear the God and that thing. So that is the reason even they also had the, being the part of temple architecture or economy kind of thing. That was there.
Okay, my next question is, according to Jha, इतने सारे जो टेंपल्स बन रहे थे वो पॉलिटिकल पावर्स का डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन बताता है. डू यू एग्री दिस पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू?
सॉरी, कम अगेन.
एम आई ऑडिबल?
या यू आर ऑडिबल. यस यस यस.
अकॉर्डिंग टू झा, जो इतने सारे टेंपल्स बन रहे थे ये पॉलिटिकल पावर की डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन को बताता है. डू यू एग्री?
आई डोंट थिंक सो. हाउ इट इज politically decentralized? How it is politically decentralized? I don't think so in my observation. But in which context he has said, we should observe that. Who means he'll be saying, he's a great scholar, I can't deny his words, but still, in which context he has said, I should see that.
Peasant exploitation
in temple architecture, associated to temple architecture. Nobody has squeeze the amount from the peasants.
I'm talking about temple architecture and also temple activities.
That's what I said. You mean that the amount or the taxation which was taken from the peasants, it was burden on them? You mean that? Yeah, that's what I said. It changes. It has nothing to do with temple architecture, what I feel, because there was a separate fund, separate land, separate, complete area, a separate hundreds and thousands of villages which was given to the temple, because the first priority which is given in our culture and tradition is temple. So it was not burden on the common people, because as we have seen, especially from 6th to 12th century or 13th century, the feudalism and the guilds and shreni, what we call, they played a major role. Okay, they have given, for example, a shreni or a guild. For example, I'm a shreni. I'm a businessman, I'm a shreni. I come to a Gujarat or a Maharashtra for other trading activity. What I do, I give the donation in the currency. I can't give the land, right? I can't give the land. I can be giving the currency or the gold coins kind of thing. So that is the, period. That is the reason why the numerous temples have came out. It's one because of the king's interest and stapatis and all. And another thing because of shrinis and guilds. Definitely they played a very major role in the temple construction activity. And we do get the inscription evidence for that also.
Can I next question?
Please.
Okay. क्या चालुक्य टेम्पल पर बुद्धिस्ट इन्फ्लुएंस देखा जा सकता है?
बुद्धिस्ट इन्फ्लुएंस ऑन चालुक्य टेम्पल्स?
Yeah.
When we see the Bajaj and Karle caves, right? They are in like Gajaprastha Akara. I can say, I feel that it's my personal, experience or observation that when we see the Bajaj and Karle caves in the near the Pune, that similar kind of structure is maybe influenced on Aihole Durga temple, because it is a Gajaprastha Akara, right? The earlier cave temples were in Gajaprastha Akara. When we see they went into the caves, right? So that cave, there is a one a text called Vishwakarma Vastu Shilpa. There he has mentioned about the cave structures, how to build the caves and all. So in that point of period, they have influenced the Buddhist cave, especially on cave architecture, what I feel. Not on structural, definitely on cave architecture.
My next and last question is...
No, you don't worry about the last question. You can please continue.
No, but we have time limit also. Okay. People have to go. Okay. So okay. This is the last, because I have three more questions from the YouTube live.
Please.
Okay,
please.
Go ahead. This is the last question, Vivek. Please. Okay, go ahead.
अगर हम विरूपाक्ष टेम्पल को देखते हैं और उससे पहले बने जो टेम्पल्स को देखते हैं तो उनकी जो प्लानिंग है और जो टेक्निकल चेंजेस हैं और जब हम विरूपाक्ष टेम्पल तक आते हैं तो बहुत ज्यादा तेजी से उनकी प्लानिंग में और टेक्निक्स में चेंजेस होते हैं इसका कारण क्या हो सकता है इसका मतलब इसका मेन रीजन क्या हो सकता है इतनी तेजी से जो ये प्लानिंग और टेक्निक्स चेंज हो रही है इन टेक्निक्स को क्या पॉलिटिकल जो जो स्ट्रगल पॉलिटिकल स्ट्रगल हो रहा है उनसे रिलेट किया जा सकता है कि नहीं किया जा सकता है
नथिंग टू डू विद द पॉलिटिकल एंड ऑल बिकॉज़ द स्थपति हैव देयर ओन वे ऑफ प्लानिंग एंड कंस्ट्रक्टिंग द टेंपल्स एंड ऑल सो नथिंग टू डू विद द पॉलिटिकल एज पर द इकोनॉमी इज कंसर्न्ड ओके अनदर थिंग देयर वाज नॉट अ इमीडिएट चेंजेस इन द टेंपल्स which we are speaking about the Virupaksha temple. Nothing that, it was a simple plan in the earlier temple. Like gradually it, developed, like Antarala, what I said, and Mukhamantapa or Gudamantapa, Nandimantapa. So gradually it didn't become overnight or it didn't become within 10 years. So it has taken the time like 50 years or centuries or 1.5 centuries like that. So on that basis, we can see the cave temple of third cave temple, of Badami Cave Temple. It is the inscription speaks about 557 kind of thing, where the Mangalesha is given the inscription. So at that point of period, we can see that was a construction of cave temples, right? And later it started like a small shrine, then shrine with the Antarala, shrine with the Gudamantapa, shrine with the Mukhamantapa, shrine with the three entrances, right? It's like an evolution process, not overnight or like within few years. It has taken time. It has taken their own time. And definitely it has influenced, got influenced by the other Stapadis and other area also. What I said, like Kalinga and Malwa culture.
Then basically इसको cultural diversity या temple diversity बोला जा सकता है.
Yeah, definitely we can say that. Definitely.
Thanks a lot, Vivek. Any question in Marathi or the local dialects from Maharashtra? Ashwini, would you like to say something? If you have any comments or questions? Ashwini? Okay, I have two more questions. Yes, from the please go ahead, Ashwini.
I would like just ask to Satvik sir about the cave temples and main temples. They just a little bit mentioned in their PPT, but I want to ask just what was the main difference between and what was the main reason behind the cave temples and main temples?
First, what is main temples? You mean structural temples?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay. So,
he understood the question, of course. It's about structure and cave temples. So, how the transition took place or why there was how they coexisted with each other and what was the difference in those times?
That's what I said in my first slide. It was the emergence of temples, structural temples. So, earlier, there were temples. There were temples. We get the evidence of a temples, which is in dilapidated conditions, which are deteriorated conditions. Definitely we'll get the temples. But what happened? The cave temples were more costlier to the king because they have to select the hill and they have to carve the entire cave. It will be very costly. See, we can see the Kailasanatha temple, right? It's a monolithic carved. So it has taken more than 100 years, 150 years. So it takes generations to carve a temple. But in case of structural temples, it is nothing, just a select a mining area and go and plot the stone slabs, okay? And select and carve them and take to the, transport to the main, place where the construction of temple is going on. So according to that, they'll intercarve or carve the pillars or any other elements. So it will be more easier for the Stapatis, okay? And the major difference, another difference is that once you make a mistake on the cave temples, it is once for all. You can't do anything. It is not, you can't erase it. It is done, it's done, okay? So it's once for all. But in case of structural temples, we can change. We can change. And the technology also improved, right? The complete temple is only based on the gravitation force. The technology is only for gravitation. Okay, they didn't add any brick mortar or any other substance inside the temple. Okay, so that was a technology developed. That was a thing happened late and which was necessity. Because it was being very costly, and this is very cheap, cheap labor, and more they can express, the Stapati can get the more liberty, they can express in their own manner. Okay, so that's the thing. These are two things.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I'm not able to hear you, ma'am. Bina ma'am, please unmute your mic.
She thanked you. Ashwini, you can further give a feedback, and you all are colleagues, so no need to say sir or ma'am.
Yeah, please.
But definitely, Satvik, it was a wonderful presentation. We all enjoyed it, not only we, but there are more than 50 participants in YouTube. There's one last question just connected to what Ashwini asked, that Kailashnatha temple is a cave temple architecture. It's carved out in a cave. So, is there any, this is a question asked by Dr. Chima from Khalsa College, Mumbai. She asked that, would you like to know if any element of Chalukyan architecture is reflected in Kailash temple at Ellora? So, is there any connections or connectivity between these two temples? And if there is any, in continuation to this question, there is a very famous guide in our city, Aurangabad, Mr. Amod Basole. He's actually the गाइड गिल्ड प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ औरंगाबाद. He's saying that if there is any connection between Kailasha and Chalukyan temples, do we have any reference to it? Reference of those times?
First of all, definitely there is a connection, because the temple model which the Krishna II has chosen to construct the Kailasha and the temple, it is from Pattadakal. Okay? On the basis, on the model of Pattadakal temples itself, there is a clear evidence on the basis of that only the Kailasha temple is made. And coming to the similarities, see, we can't say exactly what this is here we have seen. Okay, that's what the earlier, I think the Vivek Singh has asked the question. There are some limitations to the stapatis and also liberties. Okay, definitely we can see the similarities as per the Shikhara is concerned, as per the panels are concerned, as per the carvings are concerned, as per the sculptures are concerned. Definitely there are similarities, but we can't compare each and everything. Okay, this is seen here. Okay, this is also seen here. So this kind of comparison is very difficult. We should, and that's a futuristic approach. Definitely that's a very good question. That's a very good futuristic approach. Definitely we should all work on that. If there are similarities, how it is related to Badami Chalukyas or Rashtrakutas or Kalyani Chalukyas or Hoysalas, definitely there is a possibility.
Okay. So right now we don't find any important reference which says that there is a correlation between Chalukyan temples and the Kailash temple of Ellora.
That's what I said. It's just a model of which has the temples of.
But there any specific reference would you like to cite on? To this
specific reference, there is a specific reference right now. I'm not getting. I'll put it to the comment section later.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Satvik Patil. We had a wonderful session of more than 1.5 hours, which we promised already to the audience. And
before that, I'll really thank Beena ma'am.
Oh, it's really an honor to have you.
This is a wonderful platform where I got to express my a very, very, very little knowledge. Not wisdom, a little knowledge, and with all the young scholars, really I love, and I thank Ashwini and Dhanra sir for
Vivek also,
Vivek, everybody for assisting me and helping me out to present, and definitely I show my gratitude towards the Aurangabad, because I came there, the people are very lovely there. I love once again to come to visit your university, Marathwada University, and also thankful to the Marathwada University History Department as well. Thank you, everybody. And thank you for the participants, and thank you for the lovely questions, came out in such a manner. I should think and analyze, and I should answer in such a manner the questions were there. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Before Sujata, just a second. We have to especially thank all the different participants of the YouTube as well. So I think over to you, Sujata, so that we can have a closure to this session.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. Every good thing comes to an end, and so is this today's August event. But no event is complete without expressing gratitude and appreciation. So now I call upon Ms. Ashwini Khandekar ma'am to propose vote of thanks. Over to you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Sujata ma'am. Firstly, I would like to say thanks to our Department of History and Ancient Indian Culture, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, Aurangabad, and Aurangabad History Society. Collaboratively organize this program, Young History Scholars Lectures. And I would like to say thanks, especially thanks to Dr. Beena Singer ma'am, and especially thanks to Satvik Mali Patil sir for your fruitful lecture on Chalukya's temple architecture. You gave us lots of important information and explanation about the architecture and style of temple of Badami Chalukyas and Dravida or South Indian temple forms. You have provided very good information for the perspective of Indian art and architecture. And thanks to all audience for your joining and cooperation and your good interesting questions also. And thanks to our team members for a good cooperation and management. Sujata Roy, Dhanraj Gushenge, and Vivek Singh Bhaduria. Especially thanks to all of you. And lastly, I would like to say thanks to this virtual technology that provided us these service and facilities. And all members and all audience, I would like to, and our from our team and organizers, I say thanks to all.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Just a small blooper before we end. As we said from the beginning itself, when we began the session, this is going to be a monthly event. So every month we will be inviting one such young, dynamic, promising scholar for the history fraternity of the entire world, who will be the next generation knowledge bearer. And we would welcome all such young scholars. And this is open to all kind of a thing. So not only the scholars which are reaching out, which we know and we are reaching out to, but this platform is open for any young scholar who is willing to share his knowledge. So feel free to send your resume, your interest to our email ID and our official contact addresses. And as a blooper, I must introduce that today's wonderful, cheerful, charming lady who was our anchor today, Miss Sujata Roy. She will be presenting her research work on the next month in January 2021. She will be discussing something about the market culture in the traditional societies of India. And so we would like to have the continuation of this talk in the next month. So thanks from my side.
Your guidance is needed, ma'am.
Definitely, it's always there. So I hand over it to Sujata to further close everything and say end.
Yes, sir. So on behalf of everyone, I thank again each and every participant to make this event a grand success. I thank you so much, Dr. Satvik sir, to be here. To you answered everything, whatever was the question, you answered it at your best. I thank you, and thank you, Beena ma'am, for providing us